Irish, Negro, Jewish, Italian, French, and English, Spanish, Russian, Chinese, Polish, Scots, Hungarian, Litvak, Swedish, Finnish, Canadian, Greek, and Turk, and Czech, and double Czech American.
My parents met in New York in 1963. My mother's from Norway, and dad's from Barbados. I was born November 19th, 1967, shortly after the long hot summer.
Children of mixed marriages are faced with problems which tend to manifest within them reactions of guilt, insecurity, and emotional instability. They're hostile, highly irritable, overly sensitive, negative in their response to others, suspicious of others verbally, unable to identify with both parents, producing an attitude of resentment against one or both.
So, you guys decide when you're getting married?
Thank you. Ancestors weren't allowed on the Mayflower. We couldn't even get on the Juneflower. We tried to get on the Pinta, the Nina, the Santa Maria. They wouldn't even let us on the back of the wagon train. I hired a guy to trace my ancestors, and it turns out that even though there is no chiefs in my family, I am a direct descendant of the very first human being. Just imagine, my great 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 grandfather was the very first human being. So then I guess it also turned out that his wife was the second human being. So I'm actually descended from the two first human beings ever. Who else can say that?
Yes, I hear the music, always, loud, day and night. Sí, mami, déjame quieto. Yo voy a lavar los trastes, pero dígale a Rosita que tiene que barrer. Salsa, merengue, décima, Celia Cruz, Ramito Morales, Eddie Palmieri, constantly being played out loud. Hay que luchar para sobrevivir, para la comida, para nuestro hogar. I wanted to be white. I changed my name to Ralph Phillips.
I can laugh so many ways, behind my eyes, down my throat, chucking my chest, rocking my knees. There is a place in the mid-Atlantic where the sharks still go. After all these years, they still remember the blood, where millions of us got pushed overboard mid-passage to rip us apart from ourselves. They make sure our culture is forgotten.
Do you see her? Can you see her? The eternal dark one my grandmother kept in the dark. Darkness in hiding, a shadow in shadows. My family, a Filipino haunted house. The colonized and oppressed confess we spent 400 years in a convent and 50 years in Hollywood. Do you see her? Can you see her? The colonized and oppressed confess. Whose version of history taints our vision?
To love myself.
I could have passed for white.
Somebody
Ralph
told me.
Phillips.
She'd
Should
never experienced racism.
And
it was fascinating to meet a black person who actually experienced
it.
I can laugh so many ways. Behind
my
eyes, down my throat,
the eternal dark one my grandmother
kept
in the dark.
I am the dark one my grandmother
kept.
Have always been
kept in the dark. A shadow in the shadow.
I can laugh so many ways.
Should I shave my mustache?
Can you see me?
Thank you. major source of power in this society, which is the corporate sector of our economy. When you look at the higher echelons of the corporations, it still looks very much what the political elites looked like in the 50s. Predominantly well-to-do male white Anglo-Saxon mm-hmm. Protestants with selective Catholics and some Jews, but not many. You see, no blacks hardly at all, no black people hardly at all, no women hardly at all, no indigenous people at all, mm-hmm. hardly any Spanish speaking, you see. So that the next fear indeed is going to be trying to talk about redistribution of power as it relates to that corporate sector, but that's of course a gargantuan project, an enormous project that I think will be epical in its unfolding. It will be something that will not happen overnight. No, but the issue of the redistribution of economic power is going to move toward the center, it seems to me, of the agenda of those who are serious about pluralism. Because pluralism has to do with redistributing power in such a way that those whose voices have been excluded or silenced are not only heard, but they have access to power mechanisms so that what they say can actually have impact on the world in which we live. And this is so very important because it seems to me pluralism up to now has been a kind of tokenism in which you incorporate and absorb selectively certain individuals from previously excluded groups, including them into the mainstream, including them into the establishment in such a way that they are still marginalized, but their presence is used as a justification that the issue of power has been adequately addressed. And this is inadequate, it's insufficient.
All men are created equal. The concept of all men are created equal is important to Americans. Maybe all men are created equal, but who says they die that way? Riding my bike in Venice Park. I crossed the bridge and went out along the bay. What is the use of saying you are a Negro first and an American second? I say I'm an American first and a Negro second. To me, my African heritage is important, but my American heritage is more important. After riding down the road, I stopped. When I started, two white boys were following me. I'm not just a Negro of African heritage. I have the blood of many different countries in me. Irish, Scotch, German, French-Canadian, Cherokee, and more. I started cutting in near my bike and ramming my back wheel, all the while shouting, "Go home, nigger. Get out, nigger. Fucking nigger, get out." Heidi, I was scared at first, but later I wanted to kill them.
How?
Nothing has changed. Well, almost nothing. The scene is the same, only a different shell. The flowers are the same, only a different smell. The words are the same, yet they are different, for I have lost the feeling that at first went with them.
Mm-hmm. One of my earliest memories is counting the horses and buggies we saw on our Sunday drives.
What I want is peace and a world free from prejudice. By peace, I mean
the sentries stand on the street corners facing the world with gun in hand and tempers unfurled. Then a tank rolls by and a challenge is hurled as the riot rages on in Newark. I am the child of night, black. I am the child of Africa. Through the ages, I have carried brown babies on my back.
I think there's a boy in our room who likes me.
I am the child of night, black. I am the child of pride. I walk down the street, conscious I am black, my head held high.
When in the course of human events, it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bands which have connected them to another.
My future, the future of the rest of this graduating class. Yes, the future of all young people depends on a united world.
That whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or to abolish it and to institute new government.
Fight, all my brothers. Fight, all my sisters. And when the last voice has joined, tear the mother country down, down, down too long. The time has come, long overdue. The time has come. Am I black enough?
From my house.
Well, you know that I found a place that sells Café Pilón in Tijuana.
Oh,
it's crazy. Cuba is in the border and Mexico is in New York.
Well, Los Tigres del Norte will be at the Palladium in a couple of weeks.
Sí, and we've been asked to talk about the melting pot, eh?
Mm-hmm.
What do you think?
What melting pot?
Well...
Are you talking about the classic American concept of the melting pot?
Well, you know, the melting pot is like a menudo chowder. You know, with big chunks of tripe that never quite melt. See, the problem with this issue is that the blacks, the Latinos, the Asians, and the Native Americans have never been part of this cooking project, you know?
Exactly, but people don't really... That's not really the way that people have been talking about American society anymore, because the whole idea of the melting pot came from the last century when the idea was assimilation, was creating one identity, right? But the buzzwords of the 80s have had nothing to do with assimilating into one identity. It's all been about the breakdown of that identity and into a kind of static model of separate identities.
Well, it is clear that it's a bankrupt notion, you know?
Which one, the melting pot notion?
Yeah.
Well, I don't know if it's a bankrupt notion, but it's one that has a power relation built into it, which is that everybody melts into one thing that's established as the best.
But it's also an ideological notion, because we are all supposed to behave like white middle-class Americans, but we don't really know how.
Exactly. But I don't think that that's the operative notion anymore of what American cultural identity is like.
So which is the new operative notion that you see?
The whole multicultural business.
Uh-huh. Tell me more about that.
Well, it's as opposed to... assimilation and reduction of a variety of identities to one, it's now the separation into a diverse a variety of diverse identities that remain sort of statically separate from one another.
You see, what I actually see,
mm-hmm,
is a totally hybridized society in permanent state of transformation
and crisis. You have to repeat that.
that what I actually see happening is a fully hybridized society,
well,
in permanent
see,
state of transformation.
That might be what you see, but that's not what the multicultural model is about, and that's the problem that I have with the dominant culture version of the multicultural model, which is based on celebrating everybody's separateness.
But you know, the dominant culture is no longer dominant.
Are you
in
there?
Fact, if we look at the demographics, we are the dominant culture, you know?
We got cut off.
The U.S. is an immense laboratory of miscegenation, and the new Americans are hybrids. Huh. I think that...
I don't think they like that comment.
We are being surveilled in this moment.
Should we call back? Let's call back.
See, you know, I think there is a model of confrontation with the other, which pretty much defines the notion of American identity.
Mm-hmm.
And this other is indistinctively communism, minorities, third world countries, or simply people who are different from them. So, but the fact is that the enemy is always outside. You know, like for example,
but also
here,
that the enemies that they're talking about,
Eh?
Sorry, no, perdón, te interrumpí, continúa.
Sí, no, o sea que se encuentra fuera, no se encuentra dentro de nosotros, ¿no?
Uh-huh.
Como en California. Aquí, por ejemplo, cuando los californianos despolitizados hablan, por ejemplo, del immigrant flux que
uh-huh.
cruza la frontera,
uh-huh.
they mostly think of threatening images. And you
right.
can see it in the newspapers, in the local newspapers like the Union, you know. They call us the brown wave. The invaders from the south, hell at our doorsteps, you know? And other times they even think of us like viruses entering their body, you know? Or like rapists who are forcing them to have a financial or a cultural intercourse.
But don't you think that the breaking point in all of this, the change and the feeling of threat, I mean, that it's a cycle that has different, there are different points in that cycle in the sense that when the North American public was forced to become aware of the accelerated growth rate of the Latino population and of ethnic minority populations in general in this country, that was the moment when they started to get more and more hysterical about the threat.
Oye, ya te vas otra vez, no te oigo.
Bueno, ¿me escuchas?
Sí, ahora sí.
Sí, te decía, you know, that the Anglo-European cultural other has always had a bittersweet relationship with us. I actually see
right.
Several different models of relation, but they are equally negativos, no? I see, for example,
mm-hmm.
the flaneur or the passive observer who has an intellectual erotic relation with the object of contemplation, in this case, ourselves.
Right.
I also see the missionary who adventures in the territory of the other to save us from starvation, from political violence, or from aesthetic indifference in the case of the art world. And then I also
right.
see the model of the empresario, who believes he must first discover us and then sponsor us.
Capitalize.
And,
right.
and of course, you know, there is the most common one, which is the one of the cultural assassin. But we don't want to get depressed by talking about him, you know? So,
Okay.
I think that what we have to do is to destroy these models and replace them with a more symmetrical one. And I'm talking about dialogue.
Quite frankly, I'm not so sure that I, one, have the power to change what Anglo culture's attitude towards Latino culture is by changing those individuals. I feel like I have a lot more to gain by concentrating on trying to be as an intelligent representative as possible and to do as interesting work as possible. I find it really frustrating to always be looking at or worrying about the way that Anglos look at me. It's like worrying about my distorted reflection, you know, because I'd much rather be concerned about how Latinos look at each other without ignoring the fact that these other people who are there and are exploiting Latino culture in one form or another.
Well, you know, I think that one of the strengths of border art is precisely that, you know, by placing a kind of double mirror
mm-hmm.
right on the border between Mexico and the U.S. or between Chicanos and Anglos or between Mexicans and Chicanos, it subverts this traditional relationship of
uh-huh.
the North always being the speaking subject and the South always being the object of observation.
Right.
And I think that basically what one wants to do with the art is to say, hey, we are the speaking subjects, mm-hmm. and our job is to explain the U.S., but from a multi-centric perspective.
From you know, what perspective?
Por una perspectiva multicéntrica. Una perspectiva okay. multidimensional, ¿no? O sea, en otras palabras, we are rediscovering America, but with completely different eyes.
Oye, Guillermo.
Bueno.
Te estoy perdiendo otra vez.
Ya te
Repite
perdí.
Lo que estaba diciendo.
¿Dónde andas? Ahora sí ya nos perdimos definitivamente. Espérame tantito.
We got cut off.
What is America to me? The house I live in, a plot of acre street, the grocer and the butcher, and the people that I meet, the children in the playground, the faces that I see, all races, all religions, that's America to me.
Matter if a Chinese American talked like this?
Or if a Swedish American looked like this?
Because if you are a real American, you would not even care.
But some people here believe that everyone should look and talk and think the same way they do, or they should not be living in the same place.
A man called Adolf Hitler felt the same way.
Prejudice is something America can do without.
Hi, I'm Terry Doran, director of Cable Access Incorporated, the support group for our public access channel, Channel 10, right here in Fort Wayne, Indiana. You know, I'm standing here in front of the old fort, and Fort Wayne was named after General Mad Anthony Wayne, whose main claim to fame was doing away with the Indians. He did this in the name of progress and civilization. This is civilization. That's why I believe in Deep Dish. On Deep Dish, you can tell the Indian side of the story.
Our children, they grow like little flowers. Our prejudice, it poisons everything it touches. Be careful what you say to your little flowers.
to build and collect ourselves with intellect.
Come on.
To revolve, to evolve, to self-respect.
Plus, we got to keep ourselves in check.
Well, we're looking for South Park. We're from the University of California at San Diego.
Well, yeah, we have these directions. We're lost. We're trying to find this place in Logan. We're looking for the barrio.
The barrio.
We're here. It's part of a space bridge with the Soviet Union.
There's a different view. It's different from our side.
It's a very different view.
So, do you have any Latinos working with you?
You're just part of that media mafia. You always want to distort us.
But why is it that the only pictures I see on TV are of us as maids, as prostitutes, or our men members?
You guys want to get some pictures of the natives to send back to the Soviet Union? Yeah, show the wild animals around here. Show how crazy we are, la vida loca and all that stuff, huh?
We can show you our image by our own.
And this is how you represent us. Now, if we're ready for the Cisco Ramona love scene.
Quiet on the set, please. Quiet on the set.
Now, the fiery, impetuous Ramona. Is pacing nervously, waiting for her demon lover, Cisco. Now, stomp your feet, clap your hands, and deliver your line. Give me a medium shot on that. You got that?
Got it.
Oh no, this cannot go on. Where is my sultry Cisco? I want him to take me away to the Rancho Grande of ecstasy.
Cut! That was good, Ronnie, good. But, it needed something,
An accent?
Yes, an accent. Give me this instead of this, and one instead of want, and Jew instead of you, and something, you know, something...
Olé.
Yes, you will direct, young man. You will be a director. Yes, give me an olé, okay? Zoom in on the close-up on the olé, okay?
Got it.
Oh, no. These cannot go on. Where is my sultry Cisco? I want him to take me away. Olé!
That was really great, Ronnie!
Not only does America have a very serious problem, but our people have a very serious problem. America's problem is...
Getting access to this mass media. Oh, dude, this line's hype. Boy, am I hyped, I'm ready to speak this, and I am gonna diss all you suckers who trying to perpetrate me, because all you suckers are lately getting on my nerves with your white television. You suckers are whack, and I'm telling it like it is in reality. This is DJ Trippin' for me. Yo, I'ma tell you right in here. This is Trippin', and I'm clear because I'm rapping with my boy in back. We're gonna do it because we're not whack, and we're gonna do it straight to you from this San Diego we love to. We're here in downtown the ghetto. No, man, this is where I'd better be than the rich places where you make money off us. No, that ain't cool.
Children, for the city out of future.
Hi, my name is Robert.
And I'm Anthony.
And lately we've been feeling kind of angry at the recent media coverage of the Bensonhurst and Central Park case and the way they misrepresent black and white youth.
Roger Wareham spoke of the media images of black and Latino youth as animals. He brought up many interesting points, but we're going to examine these points a little closer. Let's start out by looking at two articles from the New York Magazine, which spoke about the Bensonhurst murder and the Central Park rape, which were both written by Michael Stone, a reporter for the magazine. On the surface, it looks like both issues, Michael Stone were treating both issues equally. They both have the same format, they almost have the same title, and they both have close-up photos of seven suspects.
But are they really equal?
Well, we noticed that many people like to look at pictures before they actually read an article. If you fall into this category, let me ask you a question. Do you really examine the picture that you look at? Well, let's start out by comparing the pictures of the Bensonhurst murder and the suspects of the Central Park rape. As we look at these pictures, you can see that there's something seriously wrong. Let's notice one suspect by the name of Keith Mondello, who's 18 years of age. He looks like he has a prospective future ahead of him. He's clean shaven, his hair is groomed nicely, and he's also in a suit and tie. He looks like an all-around nice guy. He looks like he wouldn't do anything so terrible as participate in a racist attack. And let's notice another suspect by the name of Charles Stressler, who's also in a formal way of dress. And Charles Stressler is the one who has supposedly supplied everyone with bats to beat Yusef Hawkins and his friends with. He's in a formal way of dress, in suit and tie, clean shaven, and his hair is groomed nicely. And let's look at one more suspect by the name of Steve Cerreri, who's also clean shaven, suit and tie. But look at, notice this picture. He looks proud. He's smiling. Like he doesn't have, that he's not ashamed of anything. But let's notice the fourth shown, which is James Patino, who's also in a suit and tie, clean shaven, and his hair is groomed properly. But we have one more suspect by the name of Joseph Fama, who seems like his pictures are being taken while he's arrested or while in handcuffs.
You know, Anthony, pictures of the Central Park suspects are totally different in dress and appearance. These pictures seem to be taken when they were being arrested. I wonder why Michael Stone, the reporter for this magazine, chose to use these pictures. What image is he trying to project of these black and white youth, black and Hispanic youth? Let's examine these pictures a little bit closer. They have their heads down, they're wearing t-shirts, hoods, and coats. Not one of these youths is wearing suit and tie. I don't understand, why did Michael Stone chose these pictures instead of other pictures? Raymond Santana, one of the suspects, is pictured with his face out in the picture. It looks like he's guilty, without any question. What kind of picture is Michael Stone trying to paint of these kids? I thought people were supposed to be innocent to prove him guilty. The impact of these images is one of guilty, without any question. But the impact of the Bensonhurst youth going to court in suit and tie is one that people might assume their innocence. Do we look like animals? Well, in referring to the Central Park suspects, the word band is used once. The word pack is used 10 times. The word gang is used 2 times. And wilding is used 5 times. Mayor Ed Koch is even quoted as calling them monsters.
Call us animals, I don't agree with them. They call us animals, I don't agree with them. They call us animals, I don't agree with them. They call us animals, I don't agree with them. They call us animals, I don't agree with them. They call us animals, I don't agree with them.
None of these animalistic words were used in the Bensonhurst article. Michael Stone used words such as whites, group of friends, mob, and Bensonhurst youths. He never mentioned the phrase wilding, never. But he did use the phrase hanging out. But do you notice that the words he used were more lightly phrased than the words used in the Central Park article?
Yeah.
Now, Michael Stone is referring to these youths as human beings.
If you still haven't gotten the idea of powers of words, let's look at an article of in Time magazine called Wilding in the Night. This article deals with the Central Park rape case and the problem of violence between young people. Look at this sub-headline. A brutal gang rape triggers fears that the U.S. is breeding a generation of merciless children. Now, isn't breeding a word used to describe animals mating? It's not used to describe human beings. Well, let's look at the words used to describe these Central Park suspects. We have roam, a word usually used, you know, to describe animals, you know. It's like, don't you get a feeling of animalistic animals? We have pack, a word used to describe dogs or wolves, usually. And then we have, last but not least, wilding, a word used by some youths in New York City.
Yeah, because you know, Robert, I could tell you, hey, I'm going wilding tonight at this party. And I could mean I'm, you know, just going to have fun, go to bug out.
Yeah, but when the media puts it in headlines or words like breeding, merciless, bloodthirsty, mob, roam, pack, and rampage, it changes the meaning. The meaning becomes one of committing acts of violence. Now, who are they talking about? Do they just mean the Central Park suspects are wilding? Or do they mean a whole generation of blacks and Hispanics are wilding? The impression on people reading articles like this one is one that they see a whole majority of black and Hispanics as naturally violent.
Well, you know, the media is not making the suspects in the Bensonhurst article out to be naturally violent animals. Let's look at the New York Newsday article that presents Joseph Vama, who was accused of pulling the trigger and killing Yusef Hawkins. Now let's read this headline. Joseph Vama is learning disabled. Now, you know, I haven't seen, headlines like this in the Central Park article. You know, let me quote something from that article that, you know, I thought was real interesting. Medical reports filed as part of a 1982 legal malpractice suit indicated that Vama suffered head injuries at the age of 3 years old. And another portion in that article brings out that another report filed as late as 1987 that Vama had an IQ of 72 or less. And then another portion that I thought was very interesting was Dr. Morton Finkel of Manhattan, who examined Vama in 1987, February of 87, stated that Vama suffered from cerebral contusion and an old skull fracture, contributing to an organic brain syndrome and minimal brain dysfunction, causing learning impairment. Come on, you know, why are they telling us about these learning impairments and injuries that Farmer had? Are they trying to make it seem like he didn't have any control over himself? Or is it that the media is trying to make it seem that they're trying to take away from the real issue? And the real issue is that it was a racist attack.
Now look, we've come to the conclusion that the media provokes racial violence by giving each group a specific title and way of being. Media makes white people feel that, hey, these black people, they're animal-like. And they see this as a reason for them to fear them and to use violence to protect themselves. The cycle of imagery and language has been going on for years. Yusef Hawkins was caught in that cycle. The media seems to be making the bond stronger. The stronger the bond gets, the harder it is for us all to fight racism. It's time for us to fight this vicious cycle.
Like the South Bronx and Red Hook. You've got a bunch of juvenile delinquents, youth gangs, call them what you want, but they're snot-nosed, chink scumbags. Now go and kick their asses. That's what you're good at.
Youth gangs? They're midget hitmen, Lou.
Who told you all this? The DEA? They've been peddling that cock and bullshit story about Chinese mafia theory for years, and they never made a case in Chinatown. I wouldn't believe nothing those clowns said.
You don't know what you're talking about, Lou. The mafia concept's not even Italian. It's Chinese. It was invented in China 1,000 years ago. They call them triads. That's what we got here, the offshoots of the Hong Kong triads.
Stanley, you're letting your imagination run away with you. You're not in Vietnam here.
No, there the difference was I never saw the goddamn enemy. Here, they're right in front of my eyes. They got no place to hide, no jungle.
The folks are now in New York's Chinatown. Now let's talk a little bit about Michael Cimino, who brought us both movies, The Deer Hunter and Year of the Dragon. I picked up a review by Tom Buckley written right after The Deer Hunters was released. He quotes from a New York Times interview with Michael Cimino, Cimino explaining, "I was attached to a Green Beret medical unit. My characters are portraits of people who I knew, the people who fought the war, whose lives were immediately affected and damaged and changed by the war." According to Cimino, at the time he claims he's 35 years old, he went to Vietnam in 1968. He was not sent there, he said, with a touch of regret. He was assigned to a special forces unit, medical unit in Texas, and it's there that he met the men who inspired him to make The Deer Hunter. Tom Buckley called the Pentagon, and if you believe the Pentagon told him, Michael Cimino was actually enlisted in 1962, not 1968. He spent 6 months on active duty instead of the 2 years he would have served if he had been drafted. For about 5 months, he was assigned to Fort Dix, New Jersey, with a month or so of medical training at Fort Sam Houston, Texas. Buckley goes on, a small number of Special Forces troops were assigned to Vietnam as advisors in that relatively quiet period. Cimino may have seen a couple of them in a chow line or even been in a class with them, but he never wore the Green Beret himself. Well, Cimino missed his war and he came to Hollywood with the intention of developing his own war, creating his own war on the set. Could this be, and this is something we wondered in the organizing movement against Year of the Dragon, is this a manifestation of a complex, psychotic director's reaction to his own misogyny, to his own being a medic who missed Miley? Is this his manifestation of his delusions of being a hero in Green Beret in Vietnam? Maybe. But I would say misogyny is par for the course in Hollywood. And as well as racism. In fact, if we look at statistics and look at different studies, most rapists in this country who are arrested and are given psychological evaluations are rated as normal. And in Hollywood, misogyny and racism is normal. And in Hollywood, Dino De Laurentiis and MGM is banking on this. Misogyny and racism could be marketable.
I don't know that there's any other word which could describe my situation at this publication other than silenced. There was an incident a few months ago in August where I made the claim in a piece on Big Daddy Kane that Beethoven was black. And this single claim and the aftermath has been the result of a collision of thinking. The result of that collision has been my effect of silencing in the Village Voice. I believe it is part of my job to let my people know what it's like on the inside, that this thing that we get every week that's rigid and fixed called the Village Voice or the New York Times or the Daily News or the LA Times is not what it appears to be. There's something about the word, the written word, that people find inherently believable. I try to tell people that it ain't what you think. I mean, don't even believe me, you know what I'm saying? Check me out. But certainly don't believe the rest of these people, especially when they start telling you what you are. Part of the reason I got into doing this was because I realized that the written word is power. The reality is African-American people in the media are functionally relegated to a good-for-nothing position. Minorities, so-called, form 1% of the management positions in American media. 1%. That's a holocaust. I wanted to describe hip-hop music. That's why I did it. That's why I do it. Writing is a pipe. And there's something else at the other end that I'm trying to get to. It's a tunnel, you know? And I know what that is. I'm not going to tell you what it is, though. I am a hip-hop activist and media assassin. A lot of people, they think those are just funny-sounding words. Okay.
I'm going to my media assassin, Harry Allen. I gotta ask him.
Yo, Harry, you're a writer. Are we that tight?
Don't believe the hype.
We have 5,000 stores in 80 countries. We're in Europe, the US, Canada, the Caribbean, the Far East. We've just entered Eastern Europe. Not just entered, we've been in Eastern Europe since 1985, but we're about to sign a joint agreement with the Russians. We're negotiating now with them to do a joint agreement where we'll be manufacturing in Russia in conjunction with the Russian government. The campaign that we did in fall, for fall 89, was a very controversial campaign because some of the images were deemed provocative and even offensive by some people. I tend to disagree with that opinion, but I very much respect their beliefs, and I also think it was a very lively dialogue about race relations, and I think that that was a very interesting thing to create in an advertising context.
We have some of these images here, so would you care to point out which ones were the most controversial?
Well, this image that's right in front of you was the image that ran in the U.S., and this was particularly controversial because a lot of people saw this image and read into it various roles or assigned roles to the two people in the ad. Actually, the image is neutral, if you can call an image of two men handcuffed together neutral. But there are no roles assigned in the photo. Both men are wearing exactly the same thing. One is white, one is black, which is very much in keeping with the campaign we've been doing for 5 years. You may interpret this as meaning we are all in this together, whatever this is, this general, the world, the, you know, the political situation. Some people looked at it and saw and thought that it was that it brought to mind an image of a convict and a prison guard, and for that reason they were offended by it, because those people were invariably assigning the role of the convict to the black man and the role of the prison guard to the white, and said that it was reinforcing racial stereotypes. That is not in the photo. So if someone has assigned those roles to those people, I think they need to examine their own belief about race relations and look at what they've read into that photo. Essentially, it becomes a Rorschach test for people's own racial baggage. You know, what they bring to the photo is what they see and not what is in the actual image. So while it was a very provocative image, and most advertisers will try not to create controversy around an ad campaign, I believe that the controversy was very good for us from a marketing standpoint, because I think our customers are very progressive, and I think that they saw what the ad was really about and not what some people viewed the ad to be. On the other hand, one of the other images that were shot for the campaign and that actually ran in Europe was a photo of a black woman nursing a white baby. And because it didn't run in this country, I don't have a better image of it, but this was from a magazine that did a story on the image. And before we considered running this ad in the U.S., we convened a panel of black journalists, some most notably from Essence magazine, who told us what we felt initially, and that was that this was perhaps too controversial an image for the U.S. market. And, you know, this brings to mind the idea of a black wet nurse nursing a white baby, and they were forced to do that while their own babies went hungry. So the people that produced this ad were European, and without the same tradition of slavery in their history, perhaps did not have the sensitivities to this image that an American might have, particularly a black American. So we deemed this image as not appropriate for this market, and I'm glad we came to that decision because, you know, in no way are we trying to offend anybody, and this is a potentially offensive image only because it does call to mind a very hurtful period in our history, and we are in no way wanting to do that. I mean, what we are trying to create here is a dialogue about race relations and a kind of why not attitude toward a meeting of people of different races.
Depends on how you mean it.
How'd you mean it?
Like I said it, now don't cry me because I didn't make up no names.
No, you breathe it in when you're born and you spit it out from then on.
That name sure bugs you, don't it? Well, that's the way it is. And you're stuck with it because I didn't make any rules.
No, but you sure live by them.
Everybody lives by them. Everybody's stuck with what is. Even them swamp animals.
Even that weasel.
You calling me a weasel?
No, I'm calling you a white man.